Thanks so much for your company across Australia. Let's begin this morning with one of the biggest fires Sydney has seen in 50 years. The Inferno, which destroyed two buildings, contained overnight. But there are still fears more walls will collapse, with road closures in place in the heart of the city.
Right now, as we go to air, there are diversions in place for Elizabeth, Chalmers and Randall Streets in Surry Hills. The bravery of firefighters can't be understated. This is what they came up against, and they walked away with no loss of life. It is extraordinary. Let's bring in our reporter Sarah Stewart live in Surry Hills this morning. Sarah, do we know yet what caused this fire?
Good morning. Well, no, that is still under investigation. We are at one of those roadblocks that you just mentioned. There are still multiple roads closed in the area. We came to this one police, so we can't go any further because this is a crime scene. Even police can't go past the next piece of tape. Once the sun comes up, there will be a lot of investigations going into what started this. There are reports that people were seen running from the building shortly after it started, but that is all unconfirmed. But as you said, those flames yesterday afternoon were absolutely enormous. Let's have a look at how it went last night.
Surry Hills, the heart of Sydney, stops dead. Embers and ash rain down. Flames and smoke tower above. Explosions rock an already rattled street. And then everything crumbles. The heat, the intensity, so fierce the building peels open.
I'm a bit in shock myself because I was right here.
It was really loud and I was like scared for the people that were around there.
And then I could even feel the flame like rain. Oh, it was scary and traumatic.
Neighbours, once strangers, waiting together for when they could return home.
Based on what we could see from the outside, all the windows were completely smoked up.
Emergency services stepping in to rescue the four-legged locals.
Did they get her?
Who couldn't evacuate themselves. And through the darkness and smoke, silhouettes of night watchmen, the firemen and women who took on one of Sydney's most terrifying blazes and emerged without a single life lost.
Oh, incredibly lucky, and I think it's a good reflection on the response of the community.
Yeah, when you look at those pictures, it is absolutely incredible that nobody was killed. We have had confirmation that one firefighter did suffer a minor burn to their arm, but it's not really requiring any major treatment. Now, as I said, when the sun comes up this morning, just behind me is where the building actually is. We'll be talking to some firefighters and trying to show you a little bit more of what's going on here.
All right, Sarah, thank you. Incredible scenes there.
Three people are dead, including two police officers, in a rare shooting and stabbing attack in the central Japanese city of Nakano. The gunman shot at officers as they responded to a call about a man stabbing a woman. Police say the suspect fled the scene, shutting himself inside a home. A deadly police shooting on Sydney's Lower North Shore is now the subject of a critical incident investigation. 41-year-old Steve Pampalian was gunned down in the driveway of the home he shares with his parents in North Willoughby. Two knives found near his body.
A male that was behaving erratically, behaving aggressively, was chasing people down the street, was approaching neighbours. He ran at police. One of the police officers then discharged their firearm.
The two officers involved are now receiving welfare support. A 15-year-old will face court today, charged over a shooting at a school in Perth's north, which sent students and staff into lockdown. And this morning we have new insight into the incident, with police releasing body cam of the moment they swarmed the school.
A quick takedown and a teenager finds himself in handcuffs. But there's no relief for these officers who rush to see if anyone is hurt.
There's a classroom at the end, they were all hiding.
School bags abandoned, but everyone safe.
It's all done, yeah.
Outside, the damage clear. Bullet holes piercing a demountable glass. In the car park, police find a car with two long-arm rifles and 60 rounds of ammunition.
Yankee 104, we are with the vehicle. Firearms are secured in the vehicle.
Students returning to the school yesterday recounting their terror.
It was kind of scary because obviously didn't know if, you know, they were going to come in. We had to move the desk and then hide underneath the desk and then just wait until we got confirmation that it was all good.
Mark McGowan also visiting the school, vowing to reform the state's gun laws.
It's not the sort of thing you expect or should expect to see happen here in Australia. It's one of those things that we all shake our heads about when you see these school shootings and other things occur in the United States.
This morning, the school will partially reopen as students try to move on from this terrifying nightmare.
Meanwhile, police are on the hunt for a man who used a firearm to hold up a gun store in Western Australia's southwest. The man is accused of stealing a rifle and ammunition from the Busselton store and terrorising the attendant with his weapon. He was last seen driving away in a silver Holden Commodore wagon. A Queensland man charged after a truck rammed three patrol cars, leaving four police officers injured, has now been identified. Bartholomew Peter Dornbush appeared in court on two charges of attempted murder and did not apply for bail. A 16-year-old boy has been charged after a collision left one person dead in Melbourne's northwest. Police say the learner driver was travelling alone in Keilor Downs, mounted the curb and struck the pedestrian on the footpath. He will face the Children's Court today.
The federal government is under pressure over its energy policy this morning after revelations power prices will surge by up to 25% from July. Nine Federal Politics reporter Eliza Edwards has the details. Eliza, there's concerns this will also not aid inflation.
Yeah, of course, Carl. With default power prices on the rise from July 1, households can expect an increase of up to 25%. It's even worse for small businesses, up to 29%. So this will inflict further cost of living pain on around a million Aussies. One small comfort, the energy regulator says the increases would have been higher if the federal government hadn't stepped in to cap coal and gas prices. But the opposition is accusing the Prime Minister of breaking a promise because he went to the last election vowing energy costs would come down in the years ahead. For those whose bills are going up, the advice is to shop around for a better deal. Carl.
Eliza, thank you.
A significant rise in the flu is impacting Queensland's hospital system with fears it will worsen a bed shortage, which has seen authorities turn to theme parks for rooms. Today, Queensland reporter Ashlyn Krukalis is in Brisbane. Good morning, Ashlyn. This comes less than a week from winter.
Sarah, it's certainly very worrying news. It's unwanted news this morning about the rate of flu cases here in Queensland. The latest figures show there are 228 cases per 100,000 people. That's well above the rates for both Victoria and New South Wales, which are at 114 and 156 per 100,000 people, respectively. Here in Queensland, there have been 500 new cases in the last week alone, many of them requiring hospitalisation. So, of course, that is putting pressure on an already stretched health system. This week we found out just how desperate the situation is when it was revealed Gold Coast University Hospital has been moving some patients to a theme park, to SeaWorld Nara Resort. Medical experts say COVID patients continue to take up hospital beds too, around 250 in the last week alone. They're saying this is the first time we're seeing both viruses co-circulating at high levels. So they're urging people to try and remember everything we learnt during the pandemic about washing our hands frequently, getting vaccinated and staying home when sick. All the while, Sarah, this is certainly putting pressure on Queensland's new health minister to increase the bed capacity across Queensland's hospitals.
Indeed. Thanks so much, Ashlyn.